Oh, we don't have to worry. See, one of the things about being sick is that gave tech the day off and everything's on your notes. Okay, everything's on your notes. So does anybody need notes? John has them, by the way. If you need notes, raise your hand. They're the notes for today's message. If you need a Bible, they're over there in the behind under the clock. So there'll be no support other than this wonderful thing. So you can imagine anything you want up there because it ain't changing. All right? Let's open our Bibles to Isaiah 26. Isaiah 26. And we're only going to look at one verse this morning. This is a verse that has really taken care of me over the years. It's a verse that has to do with what happens when circumstances invade and almost push away your dreams. You know, you have a plan for your life. You have this is what I'm going to do. Then all of a sudden something happens and everything comes crashing down. Does God have an answer when things come crashing down, whether it's self-inflicted or because of extenuating circumstances? What happens to your dream, right? When I was I went to college and me and college didn't quite agree. I loved the athletics, but you have to go to class. And after 2 years, we agreed that I should leave forever. And so I did for my college. And I came back home and I went to community college and I was an entertainer for a while and doing a bunch of things. And in the midst of it, Jesus got a hold of me and he grabbed my heart. And I found Hope Chapel and Pastor Ralph, and so in the midst of that, I had also tried out for Honolulu Fire Department, and I got in. So I went through everything. I was about to start training class. I was a reservist in the military, because I thought, well, I'll be a reservist, and I'll see where the Lord takes me with that. So I had the reserves. I had HFD, and then Pastor Ralph all of a sudden offers me a job. And so I'm going, great, I can work part-time, I can be a fireman, I got reserves, so I'm set. And then Pastor Ralph comes to me and he challenges me, he goes, you know what, it's up to you, but I feel like the Lord wants you to get out of the reserves, leave the fire department, and trust him totally, and be a full-time minister, and that's all you do. And I'm like, yeah, right. Amen to you, brother. Thank you. And so I left thinking that I'll never do that. I talked to different friends, most who weren't Christians, and they told me how stupid that was. You know, guarantee, you know, weekend warrior, fire department 10 days a week. You learn how to cook, play volleyball. I mean, what goes wrong with that? Oh, and you put out fires and save and help people. But Brenda and I were engaged at the time. And as we began to talk about it, no, this is even before we were engaged. Brenda and I were just dating. And something sat right in our hearts as we prayed that this was God's plan. And I remember I'm 22 years old, and I'm frustrated because I feel like God is invading my life, that I sense it's him, but I go, why would God do this to me? Why would God, I've got an idea. I've got a plan for my life, and everything's set. And the Lord gave me a picture later on that was of one that he wanted me. It's like a trapeze artist that is going on a line. And the picture I got that the Lord says, I want you to walk across and trust me to catch you. And we're cutting all the nets in your life. Fire department. Nothing bad about the fire department. Reserves. Nothing bad about that. But for you, John, and where I'm taking you, I don't want you to have any safety nets in your life. I want you to trust me totally. And so I did, and I got out. I got administrative discharge from the Army, the fire department. I remember the guy says, he goes, Brian, you crazy? I said, yeah, I am. And I left. And so that was 32 years ago in doing that. And there are times, I got to tell you, the biggest wrestle I have at times is with two children that were in the military, my father and the military friends, right around Veterans Day, that I feel a tinge of regret that I didn't serve my country all the way. I always feel it. But then the Lord reminds me of the picture. I tell you this because I've learned over my life that the best place to be with the perfect peace of God is when you're totally surrendered with every creative idea you have for your future. God has a plan for your life. Romans 8:28 says, even when we mess up, when God causes even our mess ups to work for good as we live in love with Him, right? So God will take a mess up and He'll turn it into a victory. For those of you that parents of little ones and you're looking, do you trust God to shape the future of your children? Even when they keep shooting themselves in the foot, do you pray over them? Do you ask God to intervene in their lives? Heaven forbid if you have someone that strays away for a season or two, do you pray at a distance for them, trusting that God has a plan for them, right? This scripture, look at it. It's just one verse. Now I'm going to show you some things in the notes, and we're just going to let the Lord kind of just speak to you this morning. But it says, Isaiah 26, verse 3, you will keep, God, you will keep in perfect peace those whose minds are steadfast because they trust in you. And I want to give you a couple words. It's going to be a little academic because I want you to see this verse. And I pray that you would let God to just etch it into the walls of your heart, right? Because it's a promise from God. It says, He will keep us in perfect peace, right? But it says, but there's two conditions. Your mind is steadfast and you're trusting Him. So let's look at these words. Look at your notes. The word keep in the Hebrew, and what I have there, for those of you that, if you want to do a little extra, you can go to sites like blueletterbible.org, and they will show you how to study a scripture. And one of the things you do is that you, the word Old Testament is in Hebrew. And so each word is there, and this one is the word natar. And what you can do, if you want to find out, well, are there other scriptures that use this word? And you can search on the word natar, and then it'll show you maybe 40 scriptures that have the same word in it. And that's how you kind of learn and grow and understand what the Bible is saying. So this word keep, it means two things, right? Look at the definition. It means to guard and watch over. So I don't know about you, when I think of a guard, I think of someone who's angry, who doesn't want to be there, but has to be, because you've done something dumb, so they got to watch you, right? So they're sitting there, and the last thing, they don't care about you, they throw you in your cell, and it's just like, whatever, you know? Something goes on, whatever, right? And so, or you're at a post, and again, soldier illustration, but you're sitting there, and you're wondering, what the heck am I doing here? Right? And anyway, the picture of God guarding is different, though. Look at the scriptures I put there. Deuteronomy 32:10, it's in section 1, number A. He kept them as the apple of His eye. Can you imagine a guard looking at you and saying, hey, prisoner, you're the apple of my eye? Maybe that'd be kind of scary. I mean, we won't even go there. But it's like, God keeps you, but the heart of Him towards you is that you're His favorite. And there's nothing that He'd rather do than to guard you, than to watch you, than to take care of you. That's His heart. And it changes the whole perspective when you say, God keeps me, God guards me. Why? Because He loves to be with you. Not only that, He likes you. So God's heart is this heart that likes you, that loves you, and it says that. But the second part about it is that there's an incredible protective element. Look at Psalm 32, verse 7 in your notes. You are my hiding place, God. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. So God doesn't say that you won't get into trouble, but He'll protect you as often as He can, mostly from yourself, because God warns us, and if we walk through it anyway, He kind of goes, He goes, okay, now I'm going to sing songs of deliverance to get you out of what you just walked into. That's the nature of God. He doesn't want you to get into trouble. But once you're in trouble, because you're the apple of His eye, He will find a way to rescue you. Psalm 18:19. He rescues me because He delights in me, right? So this is the guard. This is the God that says, I will guard you. Good so far, right? So this is the kind of guard you want in your life. You will keep, God, you will guard me. Okay, let's keep going. It says, and then it says, in perfect peace. And it's interesting because the Hebrew for perfect peace is the same word, shalom, shalom. So whenever in the Hebraic Old Testament, when they use two words in a row, it's saying, really, really, pay attention, pay attention. Important, important. Yeah, yeah. Right? And we know, no. And I won't do this anymore because that's irritating, irritating. But the idea is that he's saying, shalom, shalom. What does that mean? He will completely and soundly take care of your health, your happiness, and peace. Now, this is interesting. I've been ministering to a friend of mine who's today is a 2-month anniversary of him, his wife going to heaven. And so as we've been talking, he came to church for service. And this, he sat there and he goes, I don't like this verse at all. And we sat there, we had a time, we prayed for him and everything else. It was very difficult because he and God are not feeling the perfect peace right now. And we just in love, I said, why should you? You know, in the book of Proverbs, it says, don't sing joyful songs to a heavy heart. Do you know that's a proverb? Do you know the worst thing sometimes we can do to someone's mourning that we say, praise the Lord? Well, they're in a better place. It sounds good until you're the one receiving that because you're still mourning the loss of someone, right? Or God's got a greater plan. Don't worry about it. Everything will be okay. You know, it's just like you've done all your life this, but, you know, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean on your rock, rock. And throw him a cracker and just say, get out of my life. You sound like a parrot. Perfect peace. He will keep in perfect peace. Right? And that's what he's saying. So the Lord is a guard that loves you. He knows how to prevent you from trouble. He'll rescue you from trouble. He will keep perfect peace. Look at what the Bible says. And there's two types of peace if you want to write them. The first one, letter A, write the phrase relational peace. And under letter B, write the word situational peace because there's two types. So God's perfect peace has two parts. Number one, it's relational. Look at what it says in Romans 5, verse 1 through 5. It says, therefore, since we have been justified, just as if I'd never sinned, just as if I'd never sinned, through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Fact, if you trusted Jesus and invited him into your heart as your Savior and Lord, you believe he died on the cross for your sins, he physically rose from the dead, you've invited him into your life, then the reality is this, is that you are justified just as if you'd never sinned. You have peace with God. Relationally, that's a fact. From now until you go to heaven and beyond, you have a peaceful relationship with God. The Bible says that sin separates us. When we go to church, it's that element when we're sitting in the midst of the people and all of a sudden, whether it's something that is said by the speaker, something in the song, and we feel this tinge of a reminder that I didn't quite do that today. Whether you didn't honor your spouse or you were a little short with your children or you didn't say it to your boss, but you thought it real hard. Right? And if that thought could get there, they'd be gone. But you know, right? And something is going on. And so at that moment, you take a step back and go, wow, man, I'm not really feeling peaceful. But relational peace says this, no matter what's going on, even in here, here's the fact. Blood of Jesus, you have peace with God. Isn't that radical? Nothing you can do to change the fact that God is at peace with you. Now, that's weird because we know when we get into consternation with people sometimes that there's a moment where there's not peace. We don't feel peaceful. And we take that right to God every time. So perfect peace means that nothing in all of creation can change the fact that you have peace with God. That's why it's perfect. Not even you. You cannot destroy the peaceful bond that God has given you. Isn't that wild? So he will guard, as an apple of an eye, he will give you perfect peace. Why? Because in relationship, because of Jesus, you have peace. That's wild. So if you know you have peace, then here's number, verse 2 says, then you have access by faith into the grace in which we now stand. That means that no matter what's going on in your life, because you have peace with God, you can talk to him 24/7. 24/7, you can talk story with him. You can be with him. Wow, thank you. That was pretty good, Apple. You just popped that on, huh? That's awesome. Apple's awesome. I didn't plan on that. So now I can talk to the screen. Though whom we have faith. So you can, the thing is, because you know you have peace with God, then you can interrupt God in the midst of whatever he's doing 24/7. Somehow we feel like God's always back there, you know, doing this. You know, he's in a war room doing this. And hold that call, not right now. And it's just like, you know, take a message. And we have human pictures of God, which are Hollywood-driven, or we put our own thing on God, or maybe we have an authority figure that has frustrated us because they never had time for us, or wait a minute, or do this, versus a God of the universe who can multitask like you wouldn't believe. And when he talks to you, you are the only person in the room, even though there's 7 billion others on the planet. The sovereign God has a personal connection with 7 billion at the same time. All the while, and just so you know, he knows every star by name. I'd say he's not human. Or he's not a compilation of all the people that have been, you know, George Burns, Morgan Freeman, and all the other guys that have been God in Hollywood. But I don't know about you, but I tend to fall back to some of those pictures sometimes when I think of God. I think of the three most wonderful people, and I go, wow, he's kind of like that. Or we think of people that respect, and then we put the people that respect, even their flaws, we think that God may be like that. No, I have peace with God, and I have access in the faith. And I always, I like to put it this way. If you are stinking because you're drenched in the sin that you just committed 5 seconds ago, you don't have to shower up or pray up to go into the access of God. You need to run to the embrace of God right there, because only he can remove the stink. Only he can love you in the midst of the stink. And only he, because he guards you as the apple of his eye, knows how to wash it off of you and love you, right? As parents, we understand that. When our kids are in trouble, and we forget this about God, that when something's going on, you know, we've changed their diapers, their smell is nothing. Their things are nothing. Everything about them, it's just them. But somehow we forget that God views us that way, because we've churchified God. We've formalized him. So all of a sudden we've got to get it right and get, you know, get our best thing going before we go into his presence. By that time, we don't need him anymore. At least we need him in different ways, right? So the Bible tells us that we have access by faith, and we stand in this grace, and then we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, we'd also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Here's a radical thing. If I know I have peace with God, and I know I can go into his presence, then here's the thing. When I do something dumb, or I'm hurting, or I'm in the midst of trouble, I can go through a process, because in the end, God will be there, and he will be there through the process. My friend, who's 2 months into mourning his wife, struggling with, why did you take my wife, and all these questions and everything else. God is there. God is there through it. And he doesn't say, you know, once you get your attitude right, I'll come back and talk to you. No, he guides you through the process. No human being is like that. At some point, humans reach their tolerance where they go, you know, I just can't deal with you right now. I just can't. I'm sorry. I don't know what to say to you. Or we're there, but we're protective, because it's just like, because of someone's mourning or their anger or something, you know, it we don't want it to affect us, right? So as a human being, we can only take so much from one another, right? And I'm not saying that we got to super it up, but isn't it wonderful that we have a God that he can take everything that we dish out on him perfectly? I will guard you as an apple of an eye with a heart of rescue. I will guard you. I will keep you in perfect peace. My relationship with you will never change. And we'll get the situational towards the end, but keep going. You will keep in perfect peace whose minds are what? Steadfast. Now, this is interesting, because the word for minds, this isn't your thinking. The mind is dreaming. I will keep in perfect peace whose dreams, whose creative plans, whose imagination about the future leans on me as steadfast. had a plan for my daughter. She, after I got back from being away, she had a plan to join the military where she was going to get into med school and become a physician's assistant. And so we're like, oh, we're there. She has 4 years. And so she gets in. She's smart. Right away she gets picked. Then she meets a guy, falls in love, gets married, gets pregnant. And all of a sudden now, it's like the Army tells her, well, you know what, we'll put you on hold, and you've got a year window now, and when an opening comes up. So I'm praying because I know God's plan for her. Well, she's married and has a kid, but I know deep down God's plan is for her to be a physician's assistant. So he will open a spot in the class. So I'm praying every month, and pretty soon we're 1 month away, and I know it's God's perfect plan. I know his plan. He's going to do this. And so the day comes and goes, and he doesn't do his plan. And I fall apart. I got angry, and I got depressed for about a week. So I talked to a friend of mine, and he goes, you know what? He goes, you know, John, your problem is that you pray, and you fix your eyes on the thing you're praying on, and you don't fix your eyes on Jesus. We need to fix our eyes on Christ, not on goals. Goals are wonderful, but he is the Lord of all creative imagination. And he sees a bigger picture. Let me tell you what the bigger picture is for my daughter. She met a man who loves her, who orbits her world. And what daddy doesn't have a dream that, you know, that your daughter, I look at the Sulas, and Cody, you are an answer to our prayers because you adore your wife, and we love that. Well, I have one that does that too. Secondly, my daughter loves being a mother, and she's a good mother like my wife is. Does my prayer life and goal orientation for my children have enough room for God's creative imaginary that is bigger than mine? Or do I only see it a certain way? This is the way it's got to be. This is the way it is. Because if I don't invite God's thing into it, then I can't lean on him. You understand the difference? He will keep in perfect peace whose creative mind, and the word steadfast means to put 100% of your weight on something. Not just to kind of, oh, I'm just holding you to balance. No, it's like if you move, I'm falling. He will guard as an apple. He will keep in perfect peace relationally and situation whose mind, whose creative ideas are totally dependent on God. At every intersection. And if you're like me, it's going to cause chaos inside because we know the plans that we have for our children. We know the plans that we have for our spouse. We know the plans that we have for me. We know the plans that we have for this country and who should be president. Right? We don't even get me going there. But we have plans for that, right? And there's a creative imagination, and you're like, what person would do this and let them do that, right? Fill in the blanks. He will keep in perfect peace whose creative mind is 100% leaning on God. And here's the last part. Why? Because he trusts in him. Because he trusts in him. This creative mind of God, look at section 3, verse B. Proverbs 16, 1-3 says, to humans belong the plans of the heart, but from the Lord come the proper answer of the tongue. All a person's ways seem pure to them, but motives are weighed by the Lord. Commit to the Lord whatever you do, and he will establish your plans. This is wild when you look at this. God doesn't say, don't plan, okay? I think we ought to plan, prepare. We plan as if God's never going to show up. We plan everything. But at the end of the plan, we invite him in 100%. And he has veto power over everything. Over everything. And that's a heck, I don't know about you. I can't speak for you, but I can speak for me. I do not like giving veto power to anybody. Ask Brenda. Ask my kids. when I'm fixed that this head is right, I am right. And that's it. I don't care what anybody says. You all are wrong. You can have data. You're still wrong. Because I know what's best. Period. Right? To humans belong the plans of the heart, but from the Lord comes the proper answer of the tongue. Isn't that wild? So the picture is, think about it all you want, but the right answer is promulgated by the Holy Spirit. A mind that leans 100% on Him. All a person's ways seem pure to them, but motives are weighed by the Lord. You know what? You've gone through your litmus test, your checklist, and everything's, well, my heart is right, my this is right, my that is right. And sometimes it's nothing about your heart. God just has a more creative plan. God has a different route for what's going on. My second child, Jordo, just wonderfully, we used to call him the perfect son, you know. And it's interesting, I'm going to pick on Tiana again, because Tiana and Jordo were raised together, and they were like, if there was a fourth person of the Trinity that was a male, it would be Jordan. If the fourth person was a female, it would have been Tiana. They're just two perfect kids. They just grew up. You know, they connect with each other well. Well, Jordan went to college on a Air Force scholarship, ROTC, and he went, he's doing this, and I'm excited for him. But I see him a certain way. I go, you know, he's always going to be a good number two support guy. I've always seen him that way. You know, he's a good supporter. You know, he's not like James or my youngest, his strong leaders, you know, lions like me. Jordan's just, he's mellow like the mom, so, you know, he'll probably be a good number two or assistant. He calls me at the end of his junior year and says, Dad, I got to tell you something. I go, what's up? He goes, I've been selected to be wing commander, which is Ichiban number one over everybody. He is the man. And I'm kind of, wow, that's really good. And we talk a lot. I hang up and I go, how did that happen? Can I confess to you? And Jordan and I have talked about this. I never saw him that way. Ever. I never saw Jordan that way. But God did. And even though in the process, his own dad loved him and everything, but saw him in a certain way, the father's creative imagination had a bigger picture. So as soon as he was able to get in a situation, God sprinkled his creative imagination and he pulled it out of Jordo, who's going to make captain in a couple days. I thank God for his view of my children. I love them. I love them so much. But you know what? My view isn't big enough for them. God and Jamie saw a wonderful mommy. I never saw that. I just saw a doctor. And she could be if she wants to later. But the fact is that why can't I see the happiness she has as a wife and as a mom right now and enjoy that instead of, well, she hasn't hit my creative imagination yet. Meanwhile, years go by. I'm not gonna, I love who she is. Love my grandson. Jordo, if it was up to Dad, he wouldn't be doing the things that he does because I saw him this way. And God unpacked that dream. He will keep in perfect peace whose minds, whose creative imagination leans 100% on God is steadfast. Why? Because I trust him. And this is how we'll end. Look at this. Under trust, there's a wonderful scripture. I love to teach this message all the time. But Psalm 91 says, verses 1 and 2 at the end, it says, whoever dwells in the shelter, in the NASB it says the secret place, whoever dwells in the secret place of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. And then that scripture, never grow tired of the scripture, no matter how long you've been a Christian. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. It's interesting because think about the picture that he's saying. If whose mind is steadfast is 100% leaning on God. So this scripture is saying, get your weight off of yourself. The weight lean on God must be heavier than the leaning of your own thought process. Doesn't mean you're stupid. Doesn't mean you lack education. God made you brilliant. But he says, will you take your brilliance and lean it on God and the creator of the universe who thinks beyond what we ask or imagine, would you invite him in the process? And if you don't agree, will you wrestle your heart with him? Because no matter what you disagree with, you still have perfect peace with him. Isn't that great? To fight with someone who will never leave you, ever? That's a good fight, right? Because everything comes out in the process, right? And pretty soon, blah, 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 and you go, I never thought I felt that way. Oh my gosh. God, I can't believe you're still here. I said some horrible things about you today. My son, yes, you have, but you know what? I'm still here. That's the beauty of being in with God. And this is because in situations, now I want you to go to this last scripture, Philippians 4, verses 6 and 7. He will keep in perfect peace. I already told you about relational peace, but what about those moments when we're not at our best? Philippians 4, verses 6 and 7. In your notes, 2b, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. Check this out. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. This is situational peace. The God who never leaves you, who guards you as the apple of his eye, who's asking you to lean 100% on him, to trust him with everything you have, says, in that moment, in that intersection where your ideas seem to conflict with mine, in those moments where your intentions have shot yourself in the foot and everything in the world says, you'll never do that again. You've blown it. That's it. God says, because we have peace, come into my throne room of grace. You don't have to fix your life. Come in right now the way you are. Angry, upset, and despair, however, just come in right now. Just come in, right? And let's just settle. And if you want, God will stare at the wall with you for a while. And he says this, in that anxious moment, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, that's our entrance, with thanksgiving. And that's hard. Present your request to God, and that peace, shalom, shalom, right here, which transcends everything that you think and conceive. I don't understand. That's okay. My peace is bigger than your brain. Well, but everybody says, my peace is bigger than everybody's opinion. What it'll do, what he always does, he'll keep you. Remember, the apple of the eye guard will guard your hearts in your mind in Christ Jesus. That is too cool. That is like the greatest news ever. And this is my go-to verse. Can I just say? Every day. Every day. This is the verse that sustains me. The last 7 years, it has been my joy verse. It has been my incredible verse. As I've watched Jamie get married and have a kid, as Jordan is doing his thing, as Jeremy is on an adventure after adventure, he has this dream. And again, he has a creative imagination. I'm going, that'll never happen. And he's just, but it's a good thing I've learned by kid three to say, okay, but you know what, son? You know, you just go ahead. And I really literally did that with him. He told mom and I the plans, and we're going, get a job. And he's like, no, I'm going to do this and da-da-da-da-da. And we watched him go and God poured gas on it and it started to explode. We're going, wow, kid hears from God. I want to be more like that. I want to lead this church more like that. So Father, in Jesus' name, let's pray now. Come on up, Tim. I pray, Lord, the God who owns creative imagination, Lord God, who authors dreams that are bigger than the universe, Lord God, because your word said in Ephesians 1, before you created everything, you set a plan for each individual human being in place, Lord God. And it's huge. Your word says in Ephesians 3, verse 20, it's bigger than we ask or imagine. So, Father, I pray right now, Lord God, help us, Lord, trust you. And Lord, in trusting you, Lord, now we confess to you, Lord, the creative ideas that are not yours in our minds and in our hearts, Lord. Father, forgive us, Lord, for not trusting you with this person, with this idea. And I pray, Holy Spirit, now fill this place, Lord. And God, thank you that in the midst of all the wrestlings, Lord, you've never changed perfect peace in our relationship. And I thank you because of Jesus, I have perfect peace with you. You never change that. So God, write this scripture on the walls of our hearts. You will keep in perfect peace, whose mind is steadfast on you, because he and she trust in you. Oh God, let that be me. July 10th, 2016, Lord, I invite you to write that on the wall of my heart, Lord. From this day forward, Lord God, I will trust in you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I want you to keep your eyes closed. If you're here this morning, the Bible talks about Jesus being at the door of your heart. And he stands and knocks and waits. And all this is possible. But each human being has a decision to make, because it starts with trusting in Jesus Christ. And if you would like to open yourself to trust in him, to believe that he's more than a man that walked this earth, but that he's God in the flesh. He died on the cross for our sins. He rose from the dead. If you're looking for relational peace and you don't have it, invite Jesus into your life. That's the start. He will keep in perfect peace. It starts with relationship. Lord, I want to be right with you. So if that's your desire, I'm going to pray out loud. You pray quietly in your heart. But you tell me you're going to pray this morning. And this will be our signal. Everybody's got their eyes closed. But you look up at me, and as our eyes meet, just with that look, you're saying, you know what? I want to tell you, I'm going to ask Jesus into my heart. I want to have peace with him once for all. If that's your desire, look up now. And in a moment, I'm going to pray for you. Got you, bro. You too. Good. Anybody else this morning? I just want to have peace with you, God. You want to do that? Have you prayed that? For the two of you that looked up. God, right now, I thank you, Lord, as you're speaking this morning, Lord, I want to have peace with you. And he keeps going, and I have it, and I don't, I have it, and I don't. So today, I, with confidence, Lord, thank you, Jesus, for dying on the cross for my sins, for physically rising from the dead. My heart says this, Lord, I believe you're the Son of God. And from this day forward, Lord, no matter what I feel, Lord, I look back on this day. Today's the day that I know, Jesus, that you and I have relational peace. And nothing can separate me from you. Not even me. So, God, I stand in confidence knowing I have peace with you. So now, Lord, when I look at this scripture, you will keep me, Lord, in perfect peace. My mind will be steadfast on you. Lord, I choose to trust in you. Just take a moment. Just listen to Tim play a little longer. We're going to start to worship.